Good morning. I'm Councilman Mark Joni and Chair of Committee on Small Business, and I just want to thank you all for attending our... Just want to thank you all for attending this hearing, the first of the new session. This hearing will focus on the steps the city has taken to ensure that microbusinesses, also referred to as small local mom-and-pop shops, have all the resources that they need to survive and thrive in New York City. The character of our neighborhoods and the success of this city is intertwined with the health and longevity of the local restaurants, dry cleaners, grocery stores, and places where we buy the goods and services that make our lives more comfortable and convenient. According to the Center of Urban Future, there are more than 165,000 small businesses in New York City. According to the Red Tape Commission, there are more than 181,800 businesses with less than 10 employees that make up about 80% of all business in New York City. If just one of these businesses could add one job, that would be more than 30,000 new jobs in the city, more than 30 new salaries, new lifestyles, and new dreams for the future. The great promise of this country is the ability to make a better life for yourself and your family. And successful small businesses have carried millions of Americans toward the horizon of opportunity. And I would imagine all employees aspire to become employers someday. I'm looking forward to working with the advocates, entrepreneurs, and my colleagues from the Department of Small Business Service. We will need to draw upon the experience and expertise of the individuals in both the private and public sectors to ensure that the climate of New York City is optimal for the mom-and-pop shops, the neighborhood staples, and the other small and local businesses to thrive. I'd like to thank the committee staff, Council Ivana, Policy Analyst Michael Kurtz, Finance Analyst Aliyah, my Chief of Staff Reggie Johnson, my Legislative Director Darden Jambale for the work in making this hearing possible. Finally, I'd like to recognize the committee member that has joined us today, Council Member Perkins from the great neighborhood of Harlem. We have other council members that are in other committees, and we hope that they'll join us soon. So I just want to thank you, and looking forward to hearing from you, Deputy Commissioner.
Wonderful. Good morning, Chair and Councilmember Perkins. My name is Rachel Vantosh. I'm a Deputy Commissioner at the New York City Department of Small Business Services, or SBS. At SBS, we aim to unlock economic potential and create economic security for all New Yorkers by connecting them with quality jobs, building stronger businesses, and fostering thriving neighborhoods across the five boroughs. We are excited to partner with the new council and to continue our important work with the Small Business Committee. Today, I am pleased to testify on our support of microbusinesses. Microbusinesses are essential to the local economy and character of our neighborhoods. Small business ownership and entrepreneurship can uplift generations of families while providing neighbors with goods and services. I am the granddaughter of one such entrepreneur who started a small jewelry counter down on the Lower East Side and shaped a better life for his family. SBS serves as an advocate for small business owners like my grandfather with a focus on ensuring equity of opportunity. Helping microbusinesses is at the heart of what we do. Microbusinesses are defined by the U.S. Small Business Administration as businesses with fewer than 10 employees. In New York City, microbusinesses make up nearly 80% of businesses and employ approximately 15% of the private sector workforce. These companies cover many industries, ranging from retail to professional services to food services. They also contract with the city. More than 75% of certified minority and women-owned businesses, or MWBEs, are microbusinesses. We know microbusinesses face a myriad of challenges when they seek to operate and grow, but there is some good news. While the number of microbusinesses across the country has decreased by approximately 16%, microbusinesses in New York have increased by more than 10%. and we're working to foster that growth. Most recently, the administration worked with council to modify the commercial rent tax, saving businesses nearly $40 million per year. In addition to this recent success, SBS offers extensive, comprehensive resources to help businesses start, operate, and grow. Approximately 75% of the businesses SBS serves are microbusinesses. In every interaction, we gather feedback on the challenges they face. And from this experience, we understand microbusinesses to have four primary challenges: accessing business education, connecting to capital, complying with government regulations, and finally, adapting to changing local markets. I'm going to quickly speak about each of the challenges and the support SBS offers in each area. The first challenge we find is that small business owners often have great ideas, but can benefit from learning about best practices in business management. To equip businesses with the tools they need to compete, SBS offers free business courses to thousands of businesses per year in every borough, ranging from two-hour sessions to nine-month intensives, like the Strategic Steps for Growth program in partnership with NYU. These courses cover everything from marketing to operations to financial management. Secondly, many microbusinesses struggle to access credit. To make it easier on small businesses, SBS provides a free financing service through our NYC Business Solution Centers, which are SBS's one-stop business centers in every borough. Through NYC Business Solutions, we match business owners with the right lender for their needs and business profiles and walk them step by step through the loan process. Since the start of the administration, SBS has connected approximately 1,800 businesses to $155 million in financing. We also invest in funds where we see market gaps. For example, for businesses contracting with the city, SBS offers the Contract Financing Loan Fund. This revolving fund offers low interest loans of up to $500,000, capped at 3% interest. These funds are designed to assist small businesses, microbusinesses, and MWBEs working on city contracts. Since the program's launch last March, we've lent more than $4.5 million to 24 small businesses. The third major challenge many businesses face is complying with government regulations. While protecting public health and safety is essential, we know that these rules are not always clear and straightforward for business owners. In 2015, the mayor launched Small Business First, a major multi-agency effort to provide clear information on regulations, help businesses understand and comply with city regulations, reduce the regulatory burden, and ensure equal access for business owners. We heard directly from hundreds of business owners and created 30 commitments to save businesses time and money. Some examples include creating an online portal where businesses can see all of their transactions with the city, opening a one-stop small business support center where businesses can access multiple agencies, and launching a first-of-its-kind compliance consultation program. We've seen initial success. Since the launch, we've provided more than 17,000 services at the Small Business Support Center. There have been more than 3,000 on-site consultations with our compliance advisors, who are cross-trained individuals with a regulatory background that help businesses avoid common violations. Ultimately, we hope to save business owners millions of dollars and decrease the time it takes them to conduct business with the city. The final common challenge for microbusinesses is navigating shifts in the business environment. SBS helps businesses adapt to changing local trends, such as shifting neighborhood demographics. For example, where changing demographics may prompt landlords to speculate or harass their existing commercial tenants, SBS provides three free legal services through our Commercial Leasing Assistance Program. Businesses can work one-on-one with attorneys to review lease renewal terms, negotiate with their landlord, and even prepare court papers and motions when litigation can't be avoided. SBS also helps long-standing companies adjust to neighborhood change through Love Your Local, which provides expert business advice and grants of up to $90,000 for adaptation. SBS has a wide range of services to help microbusinesses grow and thrive in New York City. We work hard to increase awareness of these services and make them easily accessible. As I have mentioned, we have physical NYC Business Solution Centers in all five boroughs where business owners can access our range of free services. We also work closely with community partners to get the word out about our services, including leveraging our network of 75 business improvement districts. Understanding the daily struggles of a business owner, we also bring our resources directly to their doorstep. through council-funded Chamber on the Go initiative, trained business specialists canvass commercial corridors to connect business owners with our services. We also recently launched a mobile outreach unit. Along with direct business outreach, SBS also hosts outreach events with regulatory agencies to allow business owners to learn about common violations. Through our door-to-door outreach and events, we have reached nearly 8,000 business owners. As you can see, SBS is an advocate for small and micro businesses, and we are committed to ensuring they succeed in New York City. We're unique among our peer agencies, many of which are tasked with regulating businesses. Our role is to serve as a resource to business owners, no matter where they come from or what barriers they face. We look forward to learning more about the businesses in your district and partnering with you to help them grow. Thank you, and I'm happy to take any questions.
Thank you, Deputy Commissioner. Let me begin by the referral to the U.S. Small Business Administration, which defines micro business with fewer than 10 employees. Does the SBS have a clear definition on micro business?
We accept the SBA definition.
As you can see, there's controversy on the number of small businesses from different reports.
Micro businesses, right?
In general.
Yes.
Using the current definition of small businesses, what is the number of small businesses currently in New York City?
There's about 230,000 small businesses, but we have, as of 2015, about 185 micro.
And micro being with less than 10 employees. Does that take into consideration part-time or employees are defined whether part-time or full-time?
I think it must be full-time equivalent.
Full-time equivalent. Good.
Likely. I could check.
You referred to the Small Business First initiative.
Mm-hmm.
That was started and launched, I believe, in February of 2015.
That's right.
To help reduce the regulatory burdens on small businesses, what are the results so far?
So far, we've been able to close 24 of our 30 commitments, which have resulted in serving tens of thousands of business owners and making it easier for them to understand and navigate the regulatory environment in the city.
But have you done more to relieve of the burden of regulatory agencies on small business? The recent report by that Red Tape Commission revealed that there were more than 6,000 rules and regulations, 250 businesses that relied on licenses and permits, and more than 15 separate agencies that small businesses had to work with. Have we even began the focus on the overregulation or removal of outdated legislation, conflicting legislation and policies, and over-regulatory of different agencies?
Yeah, so the Mayor's Office, as part of Small Business First, the Mayor's Office of Operations is currently conducting a review of, I think, over 5,000 different rules and regulations to see if there's ways that we can make updates to those to help streamline them for small businesses. We're in the process of doing that now.
When should we expect some type of conclusion on the review?
It's going to be ongoing. So I think that, you know, as we make changes, they will be brought to the rulemaking process and we'll move forward.
So no definitive date as far as evaluating the 5,000 or 6,000 different?
I mean, we see regulatory reform as ongoing work. Like, we did Small Business First, we set a set of 30 commitments, but we're not going to stop there. Through all of the services that we offer, we get feedback on what are some of the common violations and issues for business owners. So we really see this as ongoing, and the rules review is part of that.
In your testimony, you refer to SBS has connected with approximately 1,800 businesses to $150 million in financing. Mm-hmm. Explain connected.
Sure. So we help business owners who need assistance with financing in the following way. If you are a business owner, you can come to one of our business solution centers or call, and we will will take a look at your business financial history, usually over the past couple of years, depending how long you've been in business. We'll work with you to understand what you need financing for, and then we'll help you actually prepare your financing package to go to what we think is the best lender for you. We work with 40 different lenders in the city, everything from small sort of micro lenders up to regular banks to credit unions. So we will look at your financials, identify the best match, help you package your loan application, be an interface between you and the banker all the way through being approved. So we really hold your hand through the process.
And when there's difficulties, do you help them navigate through the hurdles?
Yeah, we do everything that we can. Like, we often act as a translator between the business owner and the bankers, and help businesses sort of present their best.
And how many of those small businesses were just denied any type of credit that you couldn't help connect?
We're pretty successful in that area. I think that I'd have to check what our most recent approval ratings are, but they tend to be better than average. And we, even if someone is denied in one place, we will work with them until they're able to access the financing they need. So, for example, we've done a lot of work with Kiva. Are you familiar with Kiva? It's a crowdfunding platform where you can get access to 0% interest loans of up to $10,000, which helps a lot of people, especially micro businesses. So even if you are denied traditional credit, we will work with you to set up a profile, get backers so that you get access to financing.
Do we have the stats on the number of businesses that came to you for some type of loans? You refer to the 1,800 businesses that you were able to help connect. How many more came to you or sought help in financing?
We usually, I'd say we have probably almost double that number, but not everybody is ready to actually access financing when they come to us. Oftentimes they'll come with a question, and then through working with us realize that it's actually not the right time to seek bank financing.
So roughly 50% of the small businesses that came to you for some type of financing were not helped.
That's...
Or connected to financing.
Yeah, I'd say that not everybody is ready or actually needs financing that comes to us for help.
You also brought up the commercial rent protection. Can you define that a bit more? Explain what is it that you mean by rent protections?
So are you referring to the commercial lease assistance program?
Yep.
Okay. So we offer a service that we just launched earlier this year that pairs business owners who can't afford an attorney with pro bono legal assistance to help them review their leases, negotiate their leases, work with a landlord if they're experiencing tenant harassment.
And this is done, I guess, prior to them signing a lease or on a renewal?
Either. We will help businesses if they're reviewing a lease, either to sign it for a second time or it's a new lease, or if they're in the middle of negotiating.
So you'll be helping the tenant renegotiate the lease and defining the fair market values and what they should be expected to pay based on a square footage model, I would imagine. Is that the objective?
That is part of it. It's also looking at the lease and making sure that they understand things like what sort of property tax assessment might be passed through to them, make sure that they have rights around that, utilities, things like that.
What are the major hurdles that you see small businesses, in particular micro businesses, deal with day in and day out?
I mean, I think many of the things I mentioned in my testimony are what we hear the most often: access to financing, complying with government rules and regulations, adapting to changes in their neighborhood. And those are the primary things that we hear.
I didn't hear any mention of the impact of fees that are associated or taxes that are imposed, whether it be through real estate taxes, water and sewer, forced mandates, paid family leave, sick pay, forced health care coverage. Do any of those issues come up when you interact with small businesses?
We do hear about some of those things. We tend to focus our efforts in areas that we discussed, which we hear as the top issues as well.
But specifically, those issues don't come up as much?
I mean, we hear about issues with minimum wage, paid sick, things like that. Really, our focus as an agency, though, is making sure that business owners understand those rules and regulations and are able to comply. And where they sort of put pressure on their business operations, we try to help them adapt to those changes through all of the services that we offer.
So how can they adapt if they can't meet their obligations with minimum wage increases or paid family sick leave, health care coverage? How do you help them?
We work with them to figure out ways to increase revenue, streamline other operations so that they're able to adapt to those changes.
So if we realize that small businesses already have a challenging environment to operate, whether it be because of consumer behavior on the internet or competing with the box stores, the mega stores, chains, how do you help them raise pricing when they're already at a disadvantage and can't compete with the box stores?
As I said, we have a vast array of services, and we will help business owners across all different areas, whether it's looking at their operations or their financing, helping them access talent, helping them access capital. Those are all different ways that we help business owners adapt and grow in New York City.
But wouldn't that be a downward spiral if they can't currently meet their financial obligations to obtaining further financing? Doesn't that dig them into a deeper hole?
Yeah, and as I said, we work with them on all different ways to improve their operations. If financing is something that they need, we'll work with them there. But we have multiple courses that will help you in a really intensive way. Love Your Local, as I mentioned, is a program for longstanding businesses where someone really goes deep into the operations of a company. You get like a business consultant to sit down and work with you hand in hand, and we're providing grants for implementation of those plans. So I think we do a lot to help businesses try to adapt.
You brought up free courses. How many courses does the SBS offer?
We offer about 700 courses a year.
700.
Mm-hmm.
What subjects of those courses are covered, and how often are they, of the 700 courses, how often are they offered?
We have them about once every week across the city, and it's a wide range of classes, everything from marketing, website fundamentals, basic business planning, QuickBooks.
One a week, 700 courses.
More than that.
Okay. The math doesn't add up. 700 courses.
At least once a week.
At least once a week?
Yeah.
Okay. Are those courses offered in all five boroughs?
Mm-hmm. And we also offer, many of them are offered on site at our business.
I'm going to ask that. I'll let you ask that question.
Many of them are offered at our centers, which are located across the city, but we also do off-site courses as well in partnership with community organizations, local groups.
What would you say the single biggest stumbling block that prevents businesses with less than 10 employees, typically referred to as mom and pop shops, to grow their revenue and hiring additional employees? What would be their largest, single biggest stumbling block?
I think all of the hurdles that we talked about intersect for different business owners in terms of finding talent. You know, we work with small businesses, I'd say, in two different ways to help them in that area. First, because we know that many small and especially micro businesses don't have like an HR department or somebody to do recruiting for them. We offer free recruitment services at all of our centers. We also provide some subsidy for on-the-job training, and we also work with businesses across the city to create sort of employer-informed training for job seekers in the city.
How does the SBS advertise or promote their services?
Well, we're always looking for help, so we will take any assistance there, but we do a lot in that area. One of, I think, the best initiatives that we have in recent years we've done in collaboration with Council, which is called Chamber on the Go, and that is working with chambers across all of the boroughs to actually go to business owners' doorstep and tell them about the free services that we offer, that the chamber offers, so people don't have to come out and find us. We also recently invested in a mobile unit that brings our services right to different neighborhoods. We staff it. We can bring it to corridors all over the city, so you can just walk down the street and access our services. And then, you know, we work with community groups. We send out email blasts. Sometimes we'll do marketing for specific programs. So it's a whole range. But we're always happy for help in getting the word out.
What is the total budget of SBS?
I'd say our total city budget, it looks like $191 million with the team.
How many employees?
At SBS?
Mm-hmm.
A little over 300.
How many chambers do we have?
Across the city, I'd say probably
that
more.
That participate in the Chamber to Go program.
Oh, Chamber to Go. I think it's like seven, maybe.
Seven.
Mm-hmm. Well, then I can have the exact number.
Seven is the answer?
Yeah, we work with all of the like borough-wide chambers, Bronx, Brooklyn, and then we have some like the New York Women's Chamber and others that we work with as well. But we work with all of the major borough chambers in that program.
And I would imagine they don't have many employees, so I'm just trying to figure out how an agency with $191 million budget with 300, with how many employees, you say?
More than 300.
More than 300 employees relies on the chambers, which have very limited resources, to get the word out. I would imagine it would be just the opposite. Do they get reimbursed for Chamber on the Go? Is there any type of mechanism which
they're
helps?
Funded for it, yes.
What is that dollar amount roughly?
It's a few $100,000, I think, across all five chambers. It's council funded.
It's council funded. Mm-hmm. Per chamber or off seven chambers?
Across all the chambers.
One of the issues that was brought up to me by chambers was the procurement and the wait for funding. Are they up to date, or can you explain how they receive the few hundred thousand?
I think that we would all agree that there's ways to improve the contracting process in the city, but the chambers contract with us for this. We work with them to gather their documents, and we try to process payments as quickly as possible.
But do they get paid first or draw down on the dollar amount, or do they have to first spend the money and then get reimbursed at a later date?
They invoice us for their costs as they have them.
And how long does that payment normally take, reimbursement?
I would have to check with our payment processing team.
That would be a good concern, I think, for many. If they're, and we can treat chambers as small businesses in that matter. They are providing a service and they wait for their money after they spend the money.
We work closely with them and support them in many different ways. And we are committed to making sure that they have what they need to do the outreach that we partner with them on.
Do you offer the same to bids to help get the word out?
We will send out information about all of our services and upcoming program launches to bids.
Do they participate in helping SBS get the word out on the services and products that they offer?
Mm-hmm.
Do they also get funding for that?
Not in the same way that we do a Chamber on the Go.
How many bids are there?
75.
Seven chambers cooperate on Chamber on the Go, and 75 bids, which are more regional, don't get the funding to help promote the services or the inform the businesses of the services that you offer. Is that correct?
Not through Chamber on the Go. But we work closely with them in many different areas.
Such as?
And we have the Deputy Commissioner for Neighborhood Development here as well. But we work with them on retail attraction efforts. We work with them on local sanitation services and marketing. This is a lot of the work that the bids do.
Is that all that they do?
That is not a comprehensive list.
What would you expect the bids to do?
I mean, the bids, in terms of sharing our information, bids send it out in their newsletters and email blasts. Sometimes we'll participate in local events that the bids have. That is the way we often work with them to get the word out to their community.
What is your understanding of the purpose of a bid?
Blaze, do you want to join?
No.
Go ahead.
Hi, Chair. I'm Blaze Backer, Deputy Commissioner for Neighborhood Development at SBS. I oversee all the community-based organizations that work with us on commercial corridors in a very sort of place-based manner, which includes the bids. So I think to address the question perhaps that I understand you're asking, the work we do with the bids specifically on getting the word out is different. It's not a contracted service they're doing for us in the way Chamber on the Go is. So the business improvement districts, obviously, as I think you're familiar with, that go through a formation process that we help to oversee. The dollars that we work with the Department of Finance to get to the bids are collected through the assessment process, carry out the duties that are explicitly laid out in their district plan. So each bid, you know, within reason, has sort of a scope of work that they can put those funds toward. General sort of small business assistance in getting the word out in sort of that collective manner within the bid is work essentially that I think most bids, and I can't, you know, again, each bid is somewhat different, but most bids sort of inherently believe to be part of their underlying mission. So in many cases, what we're doing is some of this, the programs that Rachel's team puts together, it really is about just connecting the dots. So we, between regular email news blasts and the bid association and other means, gets information out to the bids that they can then distribute to their own stakeholders via their own sort of electronic means, flyering, whatever tool they find works best in their own neighborhoods. But generally, in a lot of cases, bids have been incredible partners to the agency in regards to sort of piloting new programs. So when we can get out there and we want to go out in sort of a high-touch way in order to see what might work around compliance or other means, we can work with the bid to sort of tailor that, see how it works, and then that can be sort of deployed elsewhere in the city.
You currently work with all 75 bids?
Correct.
Great. And I believe we have more in the pipeline and bid formation citywide?
Correct. We have about, again, the pipeline, we use that term pretty broadly. So pipeline could be anything from someone, a group expressing interest or a council member expressing interest, and there being sort of an active effort and they've approached us expressing interest. But we roughly say we have about, I think right now we have about 13 in any stage of sort of interest, organizing, up through sort of the legislative phase. And then there's probably about another 8 existing bids that are going through an expansion exploration. Which is a similar process.
your opinion on successive bids, generally fulfilling their obligations?
Yes, generally, I believe the model has been quite effective in helping to empower local communities and commercial districts to use essentially their local knowledge, their local familiarity with the community and what those needs are, and leveraging this mechanism by which the city partners with a bid to collect those resources, provide a lot of structural guidance and oversight. So far, I wouldn't say occasionally there are challenges we have to overcome, certainly with individual bids, and we work very closely with them to build their capacity, but certainly the model has been, I think, quite effective.
What hurdles?
Hurdles can there can be both governance and contract compliance hurdles that are just sort of the nature of running a nonprofit organization, and then there can be, of course, more programmatic hurdles where there just might be genuine challenges that an organization is having in actually carrying out the work around their commercial district as neighborhoods change, or as a community is going through land use changes or rezonings, right, where a bid gets involved. So there's challenges that are just around sort of the nature, I think, of working in the city of New York. But I think that the governance and sort of contract compliance areas is where we have certainly been putting a lot more attention for those bids that are really struggling with it. So as you may know, there's certain guidelines, for example, minimum requirements for the composition of a bid board. And some bids, just given the nature of their geography, their size, might have a really hard time getting sort of that minimum seven commercial property owners and one residential tenant, given that either the size might be too small and they've had trouble sort of engaging with stakeholders. Some bids may have very few residential tenants within their boundary, so it's particularly hard to reach sort of that threshold. So we have to work with them quite closely to make sure they're in compliance with the bid law, nonprofit law, and those things like that. So hurdles, I use the term broadly, but I mean, we're generally working quite closely with them to make sure they're in compliance, which we find to be reflective of their ability to then carry out all their other responsibilities.
And they're, just to say, they are good partners of ours in reaching micro businesses. We share a joint mission in that way, but we do take a broader approach to reaching micro businesses, and truly have worked in the past with many council members on that, so we would be happy to partner with you in any way you think is best for your district or citywide.
I have a slew of other questions, but I do want to give my colleague an opportunity to ask a few questions.
Thank you very much, Chair John. Congratulations on your first hearing.
Thank you, man.
Absolutely. Quick question about, in the last couple of terms, I've been very supportive of the street vendor community. Passed legislation in 2013 reducing some of the onerous fines that vendors were receiving for non-health related issues of being too close to the curb or too far from the curb or too close to a doorway or too far from a doorway could have resulted at the time in $1,000 fine. And we were able to get that reduced through legislation. So I was very proud to sponsor that with prior speaker, Melissa Marfavorito. What does SBS do in terms of supporting vendors who often are micro businesses, one or two or three people with a license?
Thank you, and good morning, council member. Welcome. SBS, we often hear issues with street vendors from some of the businesses that we work with, but we also believe that vending can provide a path to economic security and mobility for some individuals. So our role in that is to work with them to make sure that they are in compliance, that they're able to, do the things that they need to do to grow. So I think we take a more sort of help them to understand and build their capacity. None of our services all of our services are available to them.
Okay. Anything that's particularly targeted to, there's, thousands and thousands of vendors across New York City, a lot of immigrant communities that have people that are vending as part of their communities. So is there any specific actions that SBS could potentially take to directly engage with that community around their specific set of needs?
So, you know, all of our services, I would really say, are targeted to micro businesses and tailored for them to meet their needs. And we offer services in many different languages. We try our best to make sure that our services are culturally competent. And micro, you know, vendors are, like you said, micro businesses.
Mm-hmm.
So I'd say
Right.
So the vast range of services that we've talked about, I'd say, are well positioned for them. Happy to talk to you further about ways that we might be able to reach them better.
Additional engagement, perhaps.
Mm-hmm.
Great. Thank you, Chair.
Thank you, Councilmember. You do bring up an interesting point when it comes to street vendors and the inherent conflict between vendors and brick and mortar shops. What has SBS done to alleviate some of the conflict?
So, as a council member mentioned, the administration's been working closely with council, especially the end of last term, to figure out a comprehensive solution to this issue that takes into account both sides of the equation. We're happy to continue to work with council on that. And for us right now, you know, we work both with small businesses who have some issues with this, but also with street vendors where they need support.
So when there is a conflict between brick and mortar and vendor, what is your stance?
We work to resolve those things where we think there's a role for us on a case-by-case basis, but we really think there needs to be a more holistic and comprehensive solution, and it's something that the administration continues to work with council on.
Right. It's just interesting. I can't figure out the dynamic that if we believe that bids are successful and we are not siding with their concerns on their brick and mortar, which is their existence, the conflict is much deeper, and working on it without resolving the conflicts, such as locations and fines and street or sidewalk issues of ADA compliance and blocking doors and the lack of follow-through from city agencies on this. Where would you like to see this discussion head to ultimately come up with a platform or clear expectation?
I mean, I think we agree that there needs to be, again, a holistic solution that takes into account both storefronts and vendors. And, you know, it's a complex issue, as you've said, and I think our role in it will be helping business owners, both brick and mortar and vendors, understand what they are, how they can be in compliance, how they can avoid conflict. So I think we are in agreement that there needs to be a comprehensive solution to this that takes into account both sides.
Can I take that as a commitment from you that we can actually work on coming up with a, not only a commitment, but outline as to what is acceptable and what would not be acceptable?
I think the administration has expressed support in working with council on this.
In understanding that you would, that where SBS this function is to help small businesses thrive, would you be supportive of the HPD agency approach of notifying business owners when they're in violation and giving them a time to cure rather than penalizing those mom and pop shops?
We work with our sister agencies to allow for cure periods wherever possible. Our role in that is really to make sure business owners are informed when they have the ability to cure a violation.
Right, 6,000 different regulations for a small mom and pop shop. Mm-hmm. How can you possibly help them conform?
I mean, we help them in many different ways. I've mentioned a few of them, like our compliance advisor program, which goes to their door and walks them through the top violations, really spends time making sure they understand those violations. We make sure that violations are clear on our website. We have guides around how to avoid common violations. We have listings of all the violations. And we are, we've invested a lot, I think we've talked about, in trying to get the word out. But any support, any partnership we can have with council and how we can better reach business owners and help them avoid these violations, we are open to.
Right. So what typically a mom and pop shop finds out that they're in violation when they receive a little notice that says pay, you're in violation. What is your role at that point?
We have members of our team that work with business owners once they've received a violation to figure out if there is some path forward for them in order to cure it or to negotiate with the agencies. We have people who work hand in hand with businesses in that way, but we really put most of our efforts into helping businesses avoid those violations in the first place.
Some of these small mom and pop shops have been in existence way before legislation took effect. They wouldn't even know they're in violation. And I can give you a simple example of store signage. Shop has existed for 50 years and you have a existing sign, an ordinance dating back to 1961, which defines signage.
Mm-hmm.
I don't imagine it's much a surprise to anyone here that none of the signs are currently in compliance with that 1961 law. The fine for noncompliance, which is sporadic, is $5,000. What has the SBS done to inform these mom and pop shops that there is a signage requirement that you may not be adhering to and could subject you to a minimum of $5,000 fine?
That is a good example of a violation that business owners experience. And I think all of the things that I have mentioned around our proactive work with compliance consultations, having the information in a clear and accessible way online, those are all ways that we try to inform business owners before they receive a violation like that. And again, any thought or partnership on ways we can further our reach and make sure our services hit all the mom and pops who might experience that issue, we're open to.
Well, that's what I'm looking for, as a partner. What can we do? What role can you take now to help mitigate those fines, those hefty fines? What was once dubbed as, cost of doing business in New York City and nickels and dimes are no longer nickels and dimes. They come with a lot of zeros. How do we get ahead of this? And would you be supportive of taking the approach of informing on violations rather than penalizing and giving a time to correct and cure?
So at SBS, we believe our role is trying to make sure that business owners are informed of these violations before they get those fines and fees. So we will be supportive of working to make sure business owners are informed. We're very committed to that. It's really at the heart of what we do around regulations.
So then we go back to the question. Of the 6,000 regulations that mom and pop shops have to adhere to, how is SBS getting out the message of these regulations? 6,000. To the 100 and what is the number? 81,000?
85, yeah.
185,000 businesses.
I mean, as I said, I think we do a whole bunch of different things to get the word out about all of our services, which include helping business owners understand rules and regulations that the city have. So we use our NYC Business website. We have even classes and seminars we hold on this. We will go to business owners into their shop and for free go over all the common violations. We work to train community groups on some of the common violations so they can tell their business owners, a sort of train the trainer model. We help bring regulatory agencies to communities so that business owners can talk to them directly. So those are some of the ways that we work towards.
So I can go on your website and see all 6,000 regulations by industry, the 250 business-related licensing permits by industry?
You can go onto our website and you should be able to get all of the regulations that apply to business owners. Yes, and you can, they're searchable.
Okay. We're joined by other council members, and I'd like to give them the opportunity to ask any questions if they have.
Sure. My apologies for being late. There's some conflicts this week, and I read your testimony and I saw about the Lower East Side and the small jewelry counter, and
yes.
I represent that area, which has a lot of small businesses that are struggling.
Mm-hmm.
And we say small businesses and I guess micro businesses interchangeably because of this statistic of 80%. You know, we have a lot of small retail and commissaries. And I wanted to talk a little bit about financing. And my apologies for any questions that I might have missed about loans. I know you do a lot of referrals to banks and to credit unions to try to get them the information on how to get a low interest loan that's gonna help them. It's about security deposits. So I feel for micro businesses, the security deposits are probably one of the biggest hurdles that they have to get over, you know, in terms of not just first and last month's rent, as we typically think of security deposits, but sometimes for 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 9 months at a time, they have to make a deposit to a landlord to prove that financially they're viable and sustainable. So I guess my question to you is, what are you doing to ensure that they can get assistance with some of these loans? And of course, I know that you can't just give 6 months of a security deposit or 6 months rent to a business without an intense vetting process. But kind of what are you providing in terms of those services to help these businesses get started?
Great. So I think two questions. What are we doing to help business owners access capital? And then how do we ease the process of them getting access to commercial space? Okay.
Commercial space and really making sure that they have, again, the capital to start their business for the first couple months, making that investment.
Great. So there are two different ways that SBS works with business owners to get them access to capital, because we hear that's a top issue for businesses all across the spectrum, but especially micro businesses. If you are a business owner in New York City, you can come to any one of our business solution centers. You can call, you can show up in person, and they will help you identify what you need in terms of financing, identify the right lender for you, help you package your loan application, and then help interface with the lender in order to make the process as easy as possible. And we work with, as you mentioned, all different types of lenders, everything from banks, retail banks, to credit unions. We also work with crowdfunding platforms for business owners that aren't unable to access more traditional forms of credit. So, you know, we really take a sort of business-centered approach and make sure that they're able to get what they need. So I think that is how we work with businesses on access to capital. We also do make investments on occasion where we see there to be market gaps. So, for example, we recently launched our contract financing program, which helps business owners access low-cost capital when they're bidding on city contracts. So those are the two ways that we work with business owners to access capital. And then in terms of looking at things like security deposits and working with business owners to make sure that they can get into commercial space, we do help business owners negotiate items like that through our commercial lease assistance program. They have attorneys that can work with landlords to negotiate a reasonable security deposit, things like that. And we also, as I said, can help them make sure that they're well equipped when they get started. They have actually the money in the bank, or they're accounting for those types of costs before they launch and secure a location.
Are there any grants available? And again, I realize that when you give a grant, and the application and the vetting process would be extensive, but you know, when you consider build out and when you consider the violations that the chairman was mentioning, expenses can add up really quickly. Mm-hmm. So I wonder whether SBS ever considered a grant program just for security deposits or something. I think that has, that is something directly related to opening your doors for the first time.
So, you know, most of the time money is not free. There's only a few instances where we have done grants for SBS, and it's primarily around helping business owners in the case of like natural disasters. We will help them recover. And we have a grant program right now to help very long-standing sort of legacy businesses adapt to neighborhood change in an effort to learn what the most effective sort of adaptation strategies are so we can scale that across the city. But we do work with business owners to make sure that they have adequately planned for all of the expenses that they might have when opening a business and build that into things like their loan application.
Thank you.
Thank you.
We're also joined by Councilman Diaz. Do you have any questions, Councilman, that you want to bring up?
No, not yet.
Not yet? Okay. So let me continue then. In what areas do you think the SBS can improve the services that it offers to small businesses, in particular micro-business?
I mean, I think that we seek to improve our services all the time. We work with the business owners that we serve to understand how we could serve them better, more effectively. We're also always looking for areas that are new challenges that are coming up, and we try to offer services around them, like courses on e-commerce or social media when we hear that's a question coming up from business owners. And we also look to council members, to local community groups, to let us know if there are gaps in our services.
It sounds like you're focused more on marketing their business. We're not doing very much to help them comply. We're not doing very much to help with the burdens, the financial burdens that are put on them. Do business owners tell you that your assistance is valuable and worth their time?
Yes, I mean, we get very good feedback. The majority of businesses that we serve would recommend our services to one of their colleagues or business owner, local business owners.
Do you hear any issues of small mom and pop shops competing with the larger chains?
Yes, I mean, I think that business owners face all types of pressures in their local environment. Sometimes it can be from chain stores. Sometimes it can be the result of changing demographics in their neighborhoods. Sometimes it can be a result of needing to adapt products over time. So we work with business owners to figure out what is sort of the best plan for them in order to remain competitive and grow. What's their sort of competitive advantage?
Can you give me an example?
Sure. I mean, we have worked with business owners who are, you know, selling products that are old. Like, I always like to use, like, the Russin Daughters example. It's a company that has been around for 100 years, and they have adapted their product line over time, and we've supported them through some grants around training their employees and otherwise. So things like that, where you have a business line and a brand that was, you know, great 50 years ago, but now you bring in sort of new products for your customers, like they opened a small restaurant up the street from their store, for example.
So let's take like a traditional mom and pop pizzeria. How would you help them compete with a chain such as Domino's?
So we would work with them, I'd say, in a number of different ways. If they've been like a long-standing business in their community, they would be eligible for Love Your Local, which is a program that gives them access to a business consultant who will sit down and work with them for several weeks, like really diving in to their operations, understanding where they might be able to save money, where they may be able to introduce new products, things like that. And then we will provide them with a grant to implement those services. We also have business courses, like 40-hour business courses that we license from institutes like Kauffman Foundation that takes cohorts of business owners and helps them create like a growth plan for their business that also addresses issues like that. So we, I'd say, approach it in a number of different ways.
Would you be open to helping industries through a trade organization where they can purchase their products and services and benefit from bulk purchase discounts?
I think we'd be open to exploring an idea like that. I'd want to learn more about it.
Well, if the box stores and major chains are able to sell their products at a lower price, it's because of the services that they can purchase or their products at bulk savings. Wouldn't it be practical that we focus on that same initiative where pizzerias can buy, while keeping their competitors between themselves, be able to benefit as a buying power?
I think that is certainly one avenue where business owners can, you know, minimize their operating cost and sort of get benefits of scale, and it's something we'd be able to explore. But there are many different ways a business owner can adapt to those sorts of competitive changes in their environment, and you know, we address it in a comprehensive way. So we'd be open to looking into it.
Can you tell us about the Legacy Business Grant?
The Love Your Local Grant? We'd be happy to. I mean, we do, right now we're taking applications, so please encourage business owners to apply. Love Your Local, they can submit a preliminary application. And we're really looking for businesses that have been in the city for a number of years. And so we're looking for businesses that have establish themselves in a neighborhood, are really like a cornerstone of their community, that feel that they are experiencing pressure due to change in their neighborhood, either rising costs of real estate, changing demographics, or otherwise. And we will go through a selection process, look for sort of top businesses across the city, and once we've made that selection, as I said, match them with a business consultant who specializes in restaurants, for example, if it was a restaurant. They'll work hand in hand with that business consultant for a number of weeks and then have a plan at the end of it that goes through different ways that they could adapt, increase their revenues, change their operating expenses, if they need different types of employees, address that. They will give us that plan and a proposal to use up to $90,000 to implement that plan.
What is the total budget for the grant?
It's $90,000 per company.
And what is the total grant? How many businesses are you going to choose?
We're looking to select about 25 per year with the goal of learning through helping those companies what are the effective, impactful, scalable solutions so that we can help, we hope, you know, every legacy business in the city. Mm-hmm. And, you know, we would look forward to working with you, Chair, or any council member on the committee to make sure that we are getting the word out about that to business owners.
When is the application deadline for this grant?
Right now, we don't have a set deadline. We're collecting preliminary applications.
There's been much focus on new business and very little focus on retaining current businesses. And it's always the low-hanging fruit that we reach for. The larger businesses get many more of the resources and attention and draw to our great city. With very little investment in offering the same incentives to existing businesses. what more can the SBS do to help not only lure new business, but secure and offer the same incentives to existing businesses?
I mean, I think that it's a great question. As I've said, our focus really foundationally is on micro businesses, and many of the services that we offer speak directly to existing businesses that, you know, work day in and day out in the city. Our compliance work is really focused on existing businesses. Much of our financing work focuses on businesses that already are established. A lot of our business classes and planning, some of that is for new businesses, but our more intensive services are really geared toward business owners who want to invest time in growing their company. So I think we have a real focus and agreement with you on helping existing companies, and we'd be happy to talk through anything more we could do in any of those areas.
That's more than talk. How do we compete with New Jersey, which offers $250,000 to businesses to relocate? How can we compete with that?
SBS's role is really to offer services to help build the capacity of business owners. We do offer some tax incentives, like our energy cost savings program, that really help small business owners deal with some of the ongoing costs of doing business in the city, that helps to reduce the energy cost for small businesses, for example. But our focus is on, you know, exactly what you were saying, helping businesses stay strong and thrive in New York.
Right. So how do we compete with dollar amounts so significant that truly lure businesses to other states and away from the city? And a energy savings plan is not that enticing to stay.
I mean, I think that, as I said, our role at SBS is to really help business owners understand what the benefits are of being in New York City in terms of customer base, in terms of talent, in terms of the neighborhoods that they can work in, make sure that they are able to do that successfully and grow here.
In terms of 6,000 regulations, 250 different licenses, high real estate taxes, water and sewer rates, forced mandates, and we're going to compete with that by telling them that we're here for you. We've got a lot to do. The focus is certainly on small business. Not enough has been focused on the true economic engine of this city, and that is micro businesses. I would like to first come up with a definition, work alongside SBS and the administration to define micro business. And as my grandmother would say, because God has given us 2 ears and one mouth, we should listen as twice as much as we speak. Actually hear what their true issues are and address them. And coming up with proactive ways and not reactive ways that we can be of assistance. Our small businesses are a day away from closing up. And it's just not rent. It's the whole climate and the environment that we've created where we're not business friendly. And as elected officials, we pride ourselves when a new business opens up and we're there to cut the ribbon. And typically, we're the stumbling block that prevents them from thriving. Our businesses make the investments, risk their own monies, have a vision, and government typically finds a way to make their dreams more difficult. And once they get there, we find ways to make it complicated for them to keep their doors open. So I really want to take a hard look at some of the simple things that can be done with understanding the long game would be a comprehensive approach to a facet of issues that can easily be addressed with a willing partner, and that's what government should be, a partner, not an obstacle or a hurdle that businesses have to overcome. So I'll turn to my colleagues once again to see if they have any additional questions or comments.
Yeah. I have a question. I'm Councilmember Ayala. How are you? Thank you for coming today. So my question is really, I represent East Harlem and the South Bronx, and we had a natural disaster a few years ago in the East Harlem part of the district where we had several buildings that blew up because of a Con Ed pipe that was underneath the building that was leaking for days. A lot of our small businesses were affected by that explosion. And there were opportunities to receive grants, but the grants were grants that turned into loans if the business did not survive, I believe maybe a year after the natural disaster had occurred. And so a lot of our small businesses didn't really feel that this was something that they would, you know, be interested in applying for, even though they desperately needed, you know, the resources because they had blown up windows, they hadn't seen a customer in, you know, maybe 3 to 4 weeks. So I wonder if you know, out of that you know, disaster, SBS was able to maybe take into consideration some of these special circumstances around natural disasters and maybe modify that grant process so that it wasn't so, you know, restrictive.
Thank you and welcome. So we take a very proactive approach to addressing disasters. We both work with business owners once they've experienced a disaster. We have a team that's been doing that for many years, and I believe that Bernadette was up in your district following that disaster, helping business owners get access to a number of different resources. But we also work to ensure that business owners are prepared for any crisis or interruption like the one that you mentioned. We have a program that also goes to business owners' doors, connects them with experts in business continuity, making sure that they are able to mitigate any disaster, and provides them with a small amount of funding to help them implement some simple tools in order to prepare for any future emergencies. So I'm happy to talk with you further about what sort of grant programs might be available to businesses once they've experienced a disaster, but I also would love your help in getting the word out in your district about proactive programs to help businesses prepare for emergencies like that.
You have like one example of what one of those programs would look like? Like what do you mean by proactive programming? Because I mean, we had a bodega, right? That was smack in the middle of the disaster area. There was nothing that proactively they would have been able to do to prevent, one, the explosion, or two, the fact that that whole entire block was, you know, blocked off to pedestrian traffic, so there was no way anyone was going to go in there. I don't know how you would, you know, actively prepare for that.
So what we do to work with business owners in this case is we have hired consultants who are experts in this that work directly with the business owner. We give them to the business owner, and they make sure, you know, they make sure they have things like their records on file. They have business interruption insurance, which can help business owners once this happens, make sure that they have cash reserves on hand, help them think about how they would build that over time. We find business interruption insurance to be a major issue. Most business owners don't have that, and in the event that you're talking about, that is a way they could have received funding after that disaster occurred. So we're doing a lot to try to make sure that business owners are aware of that and are able to acquire it. And we'd love to partner with you on that.
Is it that businesses are not don't have the insurance because they can't afford it? I mean, how costly is it?
Business owners are often just not even aware that
they're not
insurance.
Aware.
Yeah, they're often not even aware that their insurance policy doesn't already cover that. So it's helping them to make sure that they are fully covered.
I'd love to be able to help in my district.
So that's great.
Whatever I can
do. We'll follow up right after
okay.
this.
I just have a quick follow-up to that because business interruption is a little bit, I think, a broader term than a disaster, right? So is that specifically for disaster-related events? I guess I'll give you what I'm thinking is what about when there is a big transportation interruption like the construction of the Second Avenue subway?
Yes, business interruption insurance can help in a range of different scenarios. In something like the Second Avenue subway, we also work to make sure that the business owners are aware of services or offerings that the MTA has around advertising, signage, and things like that.
Because I think you would agree that a number of those businesses closed down and did not return to Second Avenue. Mm-hmm. So, you know, in terms of marketing, I'm happy to help. This is not the same in terms of, I think, how disruptive it's going to be, but we're going to have an L train shut down. And while we will have a busway on 14th Street, or whatever the final plan will turn out to be, I would call that a business interruption. Mm-hmm. And, you know, a lot of our businesses on the east side are also still trying to recoup after Sandy. Some have closed down just recently. Just they can't catch up to mm-hmm. the violations. They can't catch up to the businesses, the customers that they didn't see. So, again, the business interruption, I wanted to be clear on what the definition was. And, of course, I'm very willing to help in terms of marketing.
Great. We look forward to it.
I think I don't know.
Yes, Councilmember Diaz. Please introduce yourself.
That's the chairman.
No,
I'm the great councilman from the borough of the Bronx, Councilman Diaz Sr.
Thank you, sir. Good morning, everyone. Before I do that, I'm going to do a criticism that I did in another committee that I was just in. I'm going to do the same criticism here because I come from the state senate. And now this morning I had a committee and I had to get up at 5 o'clock in the morning so I could do my thing, my hygiene, and beat the traffic, wrong all over here. Then we sat there, 8 council members, and the commissioner didn't show up. The commissioner sent an assistant commissioner. And that doesn't sound right to me. Now I come to this committee from that one, and I see again that the commissioner is not here neither. So I don't know how the city council works, but I found this very disrespectful. But that's me. And I'm not talking for my colleagues, I'm talking for me. But let me ask you a question. Do you know who's Marlene Cintron?
Yes.
Who is Marlene Cintron?
We work with her. She runs the Women's Chamber of Commerce.
No, look at me. Who is Marlene Cintron?
You want to answer?
With Bronx Overall Economic Development Corporation. I know she's partially in Borough Hall as well.
I'm sorry. We work with her on Chamber on the Go. But we work with both organizations, so I was just mixing it up.
We have so many, I think that we have many, many minority business, women-run businesses, black business, bodegas. The Bronx is full of that, and the Bronx is open for business. But you agency are the one that's supposed to help us, and help all this minority. So if I ask you who is my Lindsay Throne, I'm asking that question with a purpose. Because I want to see how involved you are with organizations that are responsible to help businesses in the Bronx. But if you don't know right away who's Marlene Cintron and what did she do, she does, and what did she do, then I'm worried. I'm worried because Marlene Cintron is the president of the Bronx Economic Development, and we need all kind of help. We in the Bronx, as I said before, we open for business, but we need an organization. We need an organization that comes and really do and really cares and really do help us and really do help our minority businesses and small businesses. And I know I'm late here, but some of the questions here that I see maybe has been already made and answered, but I'm gonna do it again. In the Bronx, can you tell me what is the your budget? How could you tell me our budget or our help in different boroughs are this in Brooklyn, this in Manhattan, this in the Bronx? And can you tell me what have you done in the Bronx?
Sure. I mean, we have a number of investments in the Bronx, including one of our business solution centers. And we actually work closely with Marlene on Chamber on the Go. We've partnered with them for the last
year. With whom?
With Marlene Cintrone, the BOEDC. We work with them and have for the last 2 years or so on Chamber on the Go. So they work closely with us to get the word out about our services in the borough.
Could you give me figure money-wise?
I would have to get back to you in terms of the exact dollar amount of our
investment. I hate that word. I have to get back to you. I hate that word. Because you know what?
Mm-hmm.
You never do.
Okay. We will get back to you. I promise. But I don't have in front of me the exact figure of investment specifically in the Bronx, but we can find that and we will get it back to you.
Yeah, because it's good to come here and say, oh, we have done, we do this, we do, but not with no specific. Then I had to ask my question, where's the beef? There's no specific, no, oh, in Bronx we have done this, and man, in Brooklyn, in Manhattan, this is what we have done, and this is the program that we have here, and this was done to help minority, to help by people that are not English proficiency, people that Chinese, Bangladesh, in my district, Chinese, Bangladesh, I have, wow, it's people that minorities that they need help. But I don't know, you know, give me a specific.
You know, we work across all five boroughs. The majority of our services are outside of Manhattan. And I will absolutely follow up with you on some of the work that we're doing in the Bronx. Wow. But we do offer our whole range of services, everything from business classes to access to capital in the Bronx. We have a center up there.
Any specific program for the Bangladesh community?
We don't have a specific program for the Bangladesh
community. Any specific program for the Garifuna community?
We try to tailor.
Any specific program for the Hispanic community?
I mean, we work with all of these communities.
Any specific program for the Chinese community?
We work, as I said, with all of these different communities across all of our services.
I was just saying you can at least confirm that there is interpretation, that there are
translations. Yeah, we offer our services in many different languages. 90% of the courses that we offer are offered in languages outside besides English, and that includes everything from Spanish, Russian, Haitian Creole, the whole range. We also have translation services available for all of our services, so we certainly make sure that our services are accessible to we hope, every community in New York City.
And does that work as a hotline, or for example, if you have for example, Chinatown or places where there is a certain ethnic community that is, they're very present or very visible, are you proactively going out there to talk to them in their own language that's
yes.
their first language?
Absolutely. We have staff members that are fluent in many different languages, and we make sure that when we go out to communities, we have the appropriate language capacity.
And appropriate literature.
Yes.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
Deputy Commissioner Tosh, what is your background? Do you come from the small business world by any chance?
I personally do not, although, as I mentioned, my family certainly does.
But you have no experience as a small business owner or operator?
I have not worked as a small business owner or operator, but I've worked with many for years.
They brought up an interesting issue when it comes to business interruption. As far as you know, would that insurance cover you something for like the Second Avenue debacle where a corridor was closed down and businesses had no access to sidewalk or street?
In some instances, it would. It depends on exactly the scenario and what type of policy you've taken out. But if something is closed down for days at a time, things like that, it will help mitigate your lost revenues as a result of that.
I'd like to look into that. Do you often hear concerns from your commercial corridors and these mom-and-pop shops when it comes to congestion, traffic?
We hear about parking from certain constituents, parking enforcement. Mm-hmm. We hear about difficulty with loading zones for commercial pickups and drop-offs. And we work on a sort of a case-by-case basis when we get complaints. We have a team that's worked with Department of Transportation, NYPD, for many years to help resolve like sort of concentrated issues. So if you're hearing that in your district, we're happy to follow up and see what we can do to mitigate it.
I think we're facing that throughout the city. But give me an example of how you deal with aggressive ticketing by traffic agents.
Aggressive ticketing by traffic agents for business owners?
Mm-hmm. For the cars that their patrons, which are parked in front of their locations and come out and after they purchase their $2 slice of pizza, have a $115 ticket to pay.
So we work with NYPD when we hear about that happening, if we get a complaint from a business owner, to understand why that's happening in the corridor. We'll talk to business owners to make sure that they understand what the local parking requirements are. But I'd say more often hear it about like delivery vehicles and other things like that. So in all of these cases, we will work with the local NYPD precinct and help sort of resolve any issues that are happening.
What are your thoughts on the administration's Vision Zero?
We think it's important to protect pedestrians and encourage safety on our roads, but we recognize that sometimes there are issues that business owners face in the areas that I'm talking about, and we do try to resolve them wherever possible.
Right, but you're specifically here to protect the interests of small businesses, not worry about pedestrians. So, and I'm not saying that they're not insignificant. Your role is focused on small business. Narrowing of roadways or road dieting and taking two lanes which already have congestion and making it into one lane has an impact on commercial corridors. Have you voiced your opinion on the effect it has on commercial corridors and small businesses?
As I said, I think we believe that it's important to protect pedestrian safety. And we do address this issue whenever we hear about it from business owners to the best of our abilities.
But isn't providing parking spaces, making sure that roads can handle the amount of traffic so customers can get to the products and services that our small businesses are offering the objective? Survivability of small businesses, isn't that your focus?
I completely agree. That
not as an individual, in your capacity as deputy commissioner.
Right, both. But yes, I mean, and when we hear there are issues, we do work to address them, I believe. Do you want to add?
Yeah, I would just add that I think, yes, as I think Rachel touched on initially, not only are we trying to help small businesses, but also neighborhoods thrive. And I think this is an area where we actually work quite closely with BIDS and our other neighborhood partners. And I think a lot of our partners will take a really holistic approach and work with the small business and with DOT. And I think from my vantage point, I would say the majority of BIDS have been quite supportive of Vision Zero. And when they're looking at both pedestrian safety, bicycle safety, and automobile safety, you know, that they've been really proactive partners in trying to look at. So if there's a you know, an active ticketing issue, is actually looking at, so let's say, the parking regulations. You know, what does the signage say? What are the meter regulations? How is the curb space to actually use? How could it be freed up, perhaps, so that there's commercial loading zone spaces as well as spaces for parking, for consumer parking? So I think that's where, when we have a partner on the ground that can be really proactive in helping to sort of survey what's happening and really understand the needs of local merchants, then they can work quite closely with SBS as well as with DOT to tackle those issues.
No. Are you saying that small businesses have approved of bus lanes, bike lanes, removal of driving lanes, and removal of parking spaces?
I can't speak to a specific instance, but I certainly do believe that, and depending on the commercial district, there have been bids who are quite aware where their consumers are coming from. So I think in some cases, in a very small, let's say, commercial district that has a sense of consumers coming there either by walking or cycling, they see those as consumers just like drivers, right? So I do think there's an attempt to look at where are people coming from and ensuring that they're sort of, you know, tackling all of those means so that they're improving the commercial district. So I don't, you know, I can't speak to a specific lane removal, but I do think there's a lot of partners in the city right now, bids among them, that are really looking at this issue and making sure that they're sort of tackling this in a way. And there's no doubt there's times where they might bring a new issue to the city's attention that helps to ensure that we're doing something correctly. But I definitely think there's a much more holistic view at the different modes of transportation that our commercial districts need to thrive.
I've met with several bids. They've brought to my attention and chambers the impact that Vision Zero has had on their commercial corridors. I have yet to hear one say, this is great, it's wonderful, it's improved my business corridor. So unless you have, of the 75, and I have not met with all 75 bids, I'd like to continue this conversation, but inherently, it sounds like we're on opposite sides of the pages here. It was overwhelming, the complaints and the impact that this has had on commercial corridors and businesses alike. So we're going
to
continue.
Yeah, I'd be happy to. I mean, I guess I would just add that, like, key components of Vision Zero include, right, sort of shorter crossing distances, curb extensions, bulb outs, like some of these things that are inherently pedestrian safety. Many cases do not take away parking or anything. They just shorten crossing distances, and those again are also improvements that are among Vision Zero improvements. And so those are, you know, additional things certainly that I've heard bids advocate for and actually request in many cases. So yeah, I'd be happy to help convene the bids and discuss this with you.
Absolutely. Yeah,
also to emphasize, if there are issues that you are hearing about from bids or in your district, we'd be happy to work with you to try to resolve them so that there is parking, there is commercial loading, and mitigate other issues as they come up.
Oh, that's great, Deputy Commissioner, because we have some here today, and I'm sure they're going to express themselves and their concerns, share them with us.
That's great. I'd be happy to give you my cards.
So at this time, unless there's any other questions, we'd like to open up the floor, and I think we'll begin with the Brooklyn Chamber of Commerce with questions.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Chamber, Third Avenue bid by Mr. Brady, and Westchester Square bid, Lisa Soren.
Yes. This is the Brooklyn Chamber. Yep.
Hi, how are you?
I'm Samara Harrison.
Good morning.
Good afternoon.
It's actually good afternoon. Started morning. Just want to thank you for being here, and I open up the floor to you.
Thank you. So good afternoon, Chair Joe Nye and members of the committee. My name is Samara Karasik, and I am Chief of Staff and Executive Vice President at the Brooklyn Chamber of Commerce. I'm delivering testimony today on behalf of Andrew Hone, President and CEO of the Brooklyn Chamber. With over 2,000 active members, the Brooklyn Chamber is the largest and number one ranked chamber of commerce in New York State. We promote economic development across the borough of Brooklyn, as well as advocate on behalf of our member businesses. The Brooklyn Alliance is the not-for-profit economic development affiliate of the Brooklyn Chamber, which includes the Business Solutions Center in the borough that we manage. Brooklyn Alliance Capital is the third affiliate of the Brooklyn Chamber and provides microloans to immigrant and minority-owned small businesses. In 2017, the average size of firms in Brooklyn hovered around 11 employees, and the majority of 20 or fewer workers. Since 2010, 40% of employment growth in Brooklyn is attributed to firms with under 50 employees, compared to 8% in Manhattan. We also have approximately 35,000 freelancers in Brooklyn, and the number of self-employed individuals is growing at a much faster rate than in the rest of New York City and the country. Small business is the heart of employment in Kings County, and we work closely with our partners in government, the community, and private industry to help these companies flourish. As you can imagine, we focus many of our programs on these small businesses, with an emphasis on minority and immigrant-owned businesses. We believe the following are key points in giving them support. One, provide mobile services traveling directly to their places of business. Owners of small firms are very limited in their ability to travel from the location of their businesses. Chamber on the Go is a critical program which enables us to reach companies that we would not be able to otherwise and offer them all of our services on site. We need to grow the city's Chamber on the Go program so that we can reach even more businesses. Offer healthcare to these businesses. Micro enterprises need support navigating our healthcare system and determining insurance costs. This is why we offer healthcare navigation services throughout the borough, and we want to increase the support we can offer in this area. Three, streamline the regulatory environment. Laws affecting small businesses change rapidly, and many may not have the in-house expertise to quickly understand new regulations and comply. We should make it as simple as possible to understand changes to business requirements and offer businesses enough time to comply. And lastly, increase microfinancing opportunities for small businesses. We have seen firsthand how difficult it can be for a small business, especially one with little or no credit history, to borrow a small amount they need to grow. This is why last year we launched our own community development financial institution. We are pleased to report that we have already made 8 loans to local businesses with an average loan size of approximately $2,000. These loans not only help entrepreneurs cultivate their business, they also help build their credit for future growth. On behalf of the members of the Brooklyn Chamber of Commerce, thank you for the opportunity to testify and for all that you do to support us as we help small businesses in the borough.
Thank you. So this was an interesting first hearing for me, and I think it's your first as well.
Yes, it is.
Great. Thank you for being here and making the time. Some of the issues that were brought up, I'm sure, impact the chamber, including, in particular, the Chamber on the Go, that many feel is very beneficial to small businesses. What else can we do to help expand, or what other services would you like SBS to partner up with on Chamber on the Go for our commercial corridors and mom and pop, in particular the micro businesses?
So Small Business Services is very supportive of Chamber on the Go. The Brooklyn Chamber started our Chamber on the Go program years ago, and Small Business Services took it to the rest of the city because they thought it was such a valuable program. We do get discretionary funding from City Council for that program, so more money means we can grow it further so that we can be out there more often, that we can have more staff working on that program. We're out every day. We work closely with members. If they want us to go to a certain corridor because they feel that there are services that are needed, then we like to work with an elected official to go out there with them to get sort of that initial introduction so they can trust us. I think being a chamber of commerce, we're not government. So once businesses realize that there's a sort of trust and value that is important in the work that we do because, you know, they understand where we're coming from and that we want to help them.
Would you be supportive of coming up with a definitive definition of micro business? And it sounds like most of your businesses are around 11 employees. Is 10 full-time equivalent a definition that you would be supportive of?
Yeah, I mean, we'd be happy to work with you to come up with a definition. I'm curious, what would the definition be used for?
Well, certainly if we identify that mom and pop shops make up 80% of all small businesses, by clearly defining them, giving them a category, we would then come up with creative services specific targeted to that group. We see the numbers in expansion and adding on additional employees, that this would be the group that could potentially be the job creator and has been the job creator for New York City. So the intent is not only to expand, to help grow, to maintain, lure, and make sure that we offer the protective services that these mom and pop shops would need to thrive in the city, and not be targeted as a group for a revenue-driven budget line item, as being targeted for failing to comply with the 6,000 codes or coming up with comprehensive ways that we could make sure that businesses are aware of the 6,000 various regulations, the 250 licenses in advance, and allowing them the time to correct any violations versus penalizing them when we identify the violation.
Of course, we'd be happy to work with you. We're very focused on our small businesses. About half of our members are 10 or less. So, you know, definition or no definition, we're on the same page that we want to help our small businesses grow and thrive, and they're the backbone of our borough.
Opinion or what is your concern when it comes to road dieting and taking away of valuable traffic lanes? Is there any impact that you're aware of when it comes to our commercial corridors? Have you heard any complaints from the small businesses?
So we poll all of our member businesses every year for what their top issues are, and transportation and infrastructure has shown up as a top issue both this year and last year. We'll be coming out soon with our state legislative agenda, which will be reflected in our city legislative agenda as well, and transportation will be on that list. For Brooklyn, because we are a pretty transit-rich borough, we find that some of the hurdles are the areas that don't have as much transit, that we want to see more of that transit. So we're focused on that. Of course, freight mobility is important as well, so that's something that we look at too. The sort of specific parking issues that you brought up earlier isn't something that I'm as familiar with, but I can go back and see historically if that's been something we've grappled with.
And is there any other suggestions besides the ones that you've mentioned after hearing from SBS that you'd like to bring to our attention on issues that may not have been highlighted in your submission?
I don't think so. I just say, you know, we love our partnership with Council. They've been very supportive of Chamber on the Go specifically, and we look forward to working with you on it.
Any procurement issues in the funding, any backlog for you or that you're aware of?
Fortunately, for now, we're okay. You know, we do front the money for these programs, but the city does pay us, so.
Is it timely reimbursement for these expenses?
I haven't heard complaints from my team, but if you want more specifics on sort of what that time frame is, I'd be happy to follow up with you.
And how is your cooperation with the local, with the other chambers?
That's great. In fact, today we have a meeting with all of the chambers to work on our initiatives together, which includes educational seminars, Chamber on the Go, a digital program to help businesses sign up to be on the Google Map, and for other digital services as well.
And your relationships with the local bids?
I think they're very good. The bid, we work through our tourism arm very closely with the bids to help drive tourism to different corridors, but also they consult with us. We just finished an economic development strategy, and the bids came in and talked to us and expressed, you know, what they thought should be in there. So we work very closely with them. And we also, you know, work to try and organize merchants in corridors where it seems like the businesses could use some organization.
Great. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you. Next, we have Michael Brady from Third Avenue Bid.
Good morning.
Afternoon.
Good afternoon, yes. I probably won't be as eloquent as my statement is because it goes a bit longer than 3 minutes. But good morning, Chair Jonai and Councilmember Ayala. Thank you for the opportunity to speak today. I understand that traditionally during the public comment period, commissioners and senior agency staff leave because they are very busy people. I thank you for staying because that shows a level of respect, because we are all very busy people, including the small businesses that have taken time out of their day to show up here. My name is Michael Brady. I'm the executive director of the Third Avenue Business Improvement District located in the South Bronx, and I'm a representative from the Bronx Business Improvement Districts. Collectively, the Bronx bids represent over 1,400 small, emerging, and micro businesses. Some locally owned mom and pops, others are larger franchises. A healthy mix of destination and convenience retailers and service providers. Together, our organizations have had a great impact on ensuring that businesses, particularly those in the outer boroughs, can thrive in a rapidly changing economic landscape that is New York City. The Third Avenue bid is the Bronx's oldest bid, has approximately 200 member businesses, slated to grow to 900 by 2019, and greets over 200,000 visitors daily. I'm here today because New York City has failed its small, emerging, and micro businesses. We as a city have not created an environment whereby our micro businesses can grow, nor where our small businesses want to stay, nor have we provided an adequate definition of those businesses caught in between. I make the distinction between small, emerging, and micro businesses because so many shops and services offered in my district and throughout New York City rarely exceed or even come close to the SBA classification for small businesses. To give you a perspective, the 2017 SBA small business table classifies a women's clothing store as a small business if they make $27.5 million or less annually. Other metrics, for example, micro businesses use the number of jobs. Others attempt to account for on-the-ground reporting, but rarely is there ever an accurate depiction of what constitutes that business's makeup, especially in New York City, where our businesses are as diverse as our people. As a result of these misnomers, many programs, funding sources, or financing tools designed for, quote, small businesses are unrealistic and do not have a measurable impact on the emerging or micro businesses' growth and sustainability or on an area's economic development. Many of these programs are flawed by their very design. Going to jump because time is short. There are a couple ways that we can help out here. Number one is cut the red tape. Make this a government of doers as opposed to talkers. $191 million is a broad budget for talking. I'm quite frankly sick and tired of being sick and tired. We need to keep city agencies accountable and guarantee an equitable distribution of city services. We need to examine the fine and penalty structure for small businesses. We need to create a system whereby the businesses can do business and do it well. This includes introducing collective purchasing or service provisions to drive down the cost of insurance, payroll, snow removal costs, etc. Stop using 311 as a false sense of security, or if we're going to embrace 311, have the issues that are reported actually handled. Additional issues include commercial warehousing, something that often plagues my district. We have a 34% vacancy rate, 29% of which is empty upper floor vacancies. There are other things within my testimony that I think address some very specific issues, and I don't want to take up the committee's time too much, but I would encourage you to take a read of them. They're very specific, and some are light lifts and some are heavy lifts. But overall, if we can accomplish one or two of the items, we will be in a much better place than we are today.
Can you give me your top two?
Sure. I think an examination of SBS and the real services that the agency provides and what the programs really do. SBS is a very large fan of using data and technology, and I think that's great. But like all statistics, they only give you the ones they want you to hear. In order to have a really good examination of the agency, we need an honest and frank discussion. What's really working? What's really not working? It's not all sunshine every day. So let's really have a good, hard look at that. And then also take a look. $191 million is a lot of money. And it really begs the question of, has SBS just become a large-scale New York City workforce program? If that's the case, great, but let's acknowledge it for what it is. There are other similar CBOs who have approximately 200 employees that run their organization on a $14 million budget in the Bronx. there's a big disparity between 14 million and 191 million. So I think an examination of the agency is a top priority. And then secondly, you know, really drilling down on commercial warehousing, commercial taxes, the transactional aspect on both the small business side, but also the property owner side. It may be a shocker for many people, but property owners, just like small business owners, are not often wealthy people. Once you account for their actual cost of doing business, they're not making a ton of money. So to demonize property owners or to demonize small business owners and think that they are these wealthy fat cats is not really productive. We have to move beyond that, acknowledge it for what it is, and have a healthy dialogue as opposed to one that has an unknown or an under you know, scored tension. I think those two aspects would really set the stage for a healthy move in the right direction.
Mr. Brady, that sounds so different from what we often hear of the duplicit devil of a landlord. And here you're referring to them as a small business and a partner.
Yeah. You know, case in point, where our offices are housed, our landlord, his family's owned the property for 30 years. They started off in retail, and then they slowly built out, and now they are mom and pop real estate developers, although they'd probably kill me if they heard me say they were mom and pop real estate developers. So they're no Thor Equities or related, let's just put it that way. And they just got a tax bill about a month ago, $400,000 for their building for this past year's taxes. 2825 Third Avenue, if you want to take a look at due diligence. And how do those taxes get paid, particularly when there's a vacancy on the ground floor? They had a credit-rated tenant, Walgreens, that was there, that they passed through a lot of their taxes, but now Walgreens is no longer there. How do they pay their taxes, but also offer a rent to a small business so they can compete? It's a very difficult conversation to have to a small business owner, but also to a property owner who has real bills. You know, additionally, across the street, there's Mr. Kwan, a 78-year-old Korean guy who's not wealthy. He still runs the cashier in his deli, and he owns three properties. His properties are adjacent to a large city public works project that's been going on for nearly 10 years. All three of his properties are vacant. Mr. Kwan has a $160,000 tax bill. How does Mr. Kwan pay his taxes? He made a $50,000 payment to the city about a month ago, and now he has roughly a $115,000 debt to the city to carry over to next year. We're not creating an environment for small business. We're not creating an environment that actually addresses issues. That's the problem with city government right now. There's a lot of talking, a lot of service referrals, a lot of financing referrals. That's not real connecting to financing. I've played the game before. I can say the bid has connected 100 businesses to financing because I referred them to Spring Bank. That's not real. That's just not. And the fact that through every council testimony, not just with SBS, but multiple agencies, we hear these facts and figures, but what are the real facts and figures? What allowed that small business to keep their lights on? That's what we're not hearing. And then we do punitive measures on the result of the city. You know, fining someone $250 because there's a bubble gum wrapper in front of their storefront. How is that enhancing, you know, the city's commercial corridors? It's not. We have made the small business environment in New York City so restrictive that the only folks who can really do business are the Pradas, the Dolce Gabbanas, the folks that are backed by these multi-billion-dollar companies that are conglomerates all around the world. Mom and pops cannot compete anymore. You know, you said earlier they're one day closer to closing their doors. That is true. It's not hyperbole. And I think that this council needs to really address it, and address it in a way that's not issuing another long report that says, oh, this is great, this is what we're going to do, but real action plans that hold agencies' feet to the fire.
Mr. Brady, you bring up some passion, and you can hear it in your voice. Like yourself, I am concerned. What would you like the SBS to focus on immediately? And you heard earlier, there's 6,000 rules and regulations that are applied to small businesses, 250 different licenses, and there's no indication that any of those regulations will be removed anytime soon, or those licenses streamlined, or the various agencies that oversee a single establishment.
Yeah, I understood the deputy commissioner's trepidation in answering that question because I think it's above her pay grade. SBS is not empowered to change regulation. Corp Counsel is. So for her, that deflection was the reality. Like, they can analyze all they want and make a recommendation, but we all know that, you know, legal is the one that's going to have to override that. And I'm sure you know as well as I, to work through the state legal department is just as similar as working through the city's legal department. It's very slow. So I think that's an unrealistic expectation. You know, an honest thing that SBS could do tomorrow that would help out, probably double their business owner participation count, is offering their workshops at night in the borough where there's interest. I had a business, she owns a cleaning company. She wanted to be an MWBE. The only MWBE workshop was offered in Brooklyn at 9 a.m. Peak time for her business to do business. What the hell is that? And this is indicative of a lot of things with SBS. And then, you know, the 700 workshops annually, that means SBS is offering 2 workshops a day. That's a little ridiculous because that's not true. Unless we're counting or unduplicated counts of partner organizations that are doing it for them. Let's drill down on that. What are the actual workshops? What are the actual attendee counts? I can speak for the other bids. Whenever we do a workshop, the amount of paperwork that we have to do to prove that we did it is enormous. We have to sign-in sheets, the number of sign-in sheets, scan the sign-in sheets, send them to a grant manager. Now, mind you, we're business improvement districts. We're funded by a property owner assessment, not funded by city government. It just so happens that SBS and Department of Tax and Finance started to collect the assessment on our behalfs. But we're not funded by city government. We're funded by private property owners in our districts. And that is something that SBS often forgets. They think that the bids are these little redheaded stepchildren that will fawn to them when they need them, but they're really not a major component of commercial corridors. But I can tell you right now, the Third Avenue bid, the Westchester Square bid, the Fordham Road bid, the Gun Hill bid, our property owners will come to us, our business owners will come to us, our community residents will come to us before they come to city government. And we've got the stats to back that up.
When they do come to you, do you find SBS's embracing of the bids in helping navigate or address the issues?
They are helpful to a point. Usually in my district, we deal with non-compliant vendors, we deal with homelessness, we deal with opioid use, we deal with large-scale public works projects that are not completed on time. Not on time means 10 years old. And the feedback that we get from SBS, and this is a little troubling, I understand your challenges, and we're doing everything we can. Now, I can't help but think that either I'm being blown off or that's the reality. And if that's the reality, that's really scary.
I'm not understanding. Why are you dealing with opioid homelessness issues?
Because they all affect small businesses. No one's going to go to a commercial corridor. No one's going to patronize a small business if you have people who are overdosing in front of the store. And New York City has not adequately addressed the opioid epidemic. Councilmember Ayala had a very lively committee meeting yesterday. But the city as a whole lags behind the country and the world in addressing this issue. You know, I was on a task force for Canada, and I was with the Canadian Minister of Health. What they did 10 years ago is just what New York City is doing now. Now, for being an innovative city that cares about our small businesses and our people and our pedestrians, we really have to examine whether that's true.
Please elaborate a little bit more. So you're focusing on opioid addiction problems,
so,
epidemic, and homelessness, and how does that affect your focus, which is?
Small businesses. Our bid is unlike a lot of downtown bids or Manhattan bids. In order to ensure that we have no vacancies in our buildings, and ensure that we can drive the pedestrian foot traffic, we're in one of the most transit-rich hubs in the Bronx, to our stores, to keep those stores open, we have to go to the true bid axiom, which is clean, safe, and beautiful. Any bid director will always tell you, that's what we do, clean, safe, and beautiful. our bid does clean, safe, and beautiful, but we actually make it count by offering policies or ways to address the opioid epidemic, which is plaguing our hub. We're actually the number one area in the Bronx for the opioid epidemic, and also the one that gets the least amount of services. Highest number of shelters and highest number of methadone clinics, but least amount of real services. That's how we're working to address the drug issue, because it impacts our businesses. Just this past weekend, I got a call on my cell phone from a jewelry store owner who had a substance abuser just come into a store and just hang out. Very small jewelry shop. The gentleman was probably very high. That's not a healthy environment for business. If you would you go and buy your wife a ring in a store that had that? Probably not. Similarly, homelessness affects our sidewalks. It affects pedestrian crosswalks. It affects just the appearance of your commercial corridor, something the city doesn't address. In order to have a mattress removed from our sidewalk, a mattress, if you're throwing away a mattress and you're putting it out, we have to have someone from NYPD, a sanitation supervisor, and a representative from Bronx Works, who's our homeless outreach provider for our area, all meet at the mattress and say that no one owns the mattress and that it can be thrown away.
I don't understand. So if someone throws out a mattress in the garbage but discarded, mm-hmm. and it winds up on a sidewalk, you need three agencies there to have that mattress removed?
We need three agencies to sign off so the city doesn't get sued for throwing out someone's property. There was a case, I believe, that was 6 to 8 months ago where a homeless person sued the city of Newark for throwing away their possessions because the city was cleaning up a homeless encampment, and successfully won a lawsuit. And now these are the new policies that we have to enforce.
How long does it take for those three agencies to come together?
I will ask, how long does it take you to meet with your colleagues and schedule that? It takes a while.
So the mattress is?
On the sidewalk.
On the sidewalk. Property owner, store owner cannot remove it.
Correct. And now throw on top of that 200,000 pedestrians a day. Now, you'd think that this would be the exact time where the Small Business Services Agency would act as an ombudsman and address the situation. That doesn't happen.
When that happens, does sanitation also give an issue, a violation to the property owner or the store owner?
Depending on how close it is to the sidewalk and the proximity to that property owner's or that store owner's entrance. Correct.
We're going to have to continue that. I need to call up a few more of the people. Thank you both for your time, and I'm looking forward to being a real partner as we address the issues of small businesses together. Thank you. Calling up Evie Verrett. And Armando, your handwriting is just as bad as mine. Thank you, Armando.
I'm not meaning to rush you, but I'm going to have a lot of people coming up here for juvenile justice.
Got it.
And hanging out, I'm always known.
Good afternoon. Hit the button. No, hit the button.
Button. There you go. Thank you, Armando. Good afternoon. My name is Evie Virouet. I am a small business organizer with the Northwest Bronx Community and Clergy Coalition. So I am here just to tell you my personal story as an organizer. Okay, so I began organizing the Kingsbridge-Jerome corridor back in 2016. Okay, so I began outreaching and strategizing and getting to meet some of these small business owners. And with all due respect, these are small business owners that own bodegas, beauty salons, and flower shops, et cetera, et cetera. So throughout developing and also communicating a good trust with these people, I have found that they are in distress, especially when it comes to their small business. They own the business, they don't own the property. So they're having many, many issues with their landlords. So many of them don't have leases. There is what we call a no-lease corner, which is small, 12 small business owners that don't have a lease owned by the same landlord. So we have been trying to negotiate a one-year, two-year lease in order for them to at least get started. These small businesses cannot get a loan. Okay, they cannot go to a bank and ask for a loan or even file an application because they don't have a lease. Okay, many of the landlords in the corridor do negotiate with the small business owner, but you have many that do not. And I get many phone calls, councilmen, many phone calls. Throughout the weekend, they will call and they would say being harassed by a landlord because they owe rent. Now, with these small business owners, a lot of situations that are happening, especially during the winter time, these small business owners with the no-lease corner, okay, so they had a piping system that was never directed with SBS. So they had no heat since 1997. Okay, I called SBS to see if they can help out, try to figure out what's happening, at least to have some backup. Okay, I called the landlord and told the landlord about the situation. Okay, HVAC systems aren't working, haven't been working since 1997. I called Department of Buildings, and I also called Department of Finance just to see what's happening with this landlord. Okay, so what happened was that Con Edison shut them down. Okay, so they had to either make a decision. Okay, they either had to not pay rent for them to get all this fixed with this piping. But unfortunately, what had happened was I stepped in and I spoke to the landlord and I told the landlord that I would definitely make it my business to make sure all of them take him to court. So that's where everything started getting a little better throughout the wintertime. But just to make a long story short, I really think that our elected officials need to get involved. Okay, not just one or two in each district. We need all elected officials getting involved, especially with these small businesses that don't have leases, and many have been owning their shops for 20 and 30 years. Okay, just to see if we can come up with some solution. Okay, so my time is up. Thank you.
I want to follow up with you on that. We certainly will. They're recently passed an initiative that will be offering free legal services to these small businesses that can help negotiate with their landlords, and I will fill you in on that as well.
Sir, right now on deck, we have three businesses that have legal services, legal representation through SBS. Okay, and they're just going around asking for, you know, if they need extra help. But we have communicated with the lawyers, so we're good with that.
Excellent.
Okay, thank you.
Good afternoon. Thank you, Chair Joe Nye, for the opportunity to provide this testimony. My name is Armando Moritz-Chapelikin. I am the campaign coordinator for Equitable Economic Development at the Association for Neighborhood and Housing Development, or ANHD. Also speaking as a part of United for Small Business NYC, which is a citywide coalition of community organizations, including Northwest Bronx Community Clergy Coalition, that is working to support and protect New York City small businesses from the threat of displacement, with particular focus on owner-operated, low-income, minority, and immigrant-run businesses. And one note I'd actually just want to make on the Commercial Lease Assistance Program, we actually worked really closely as a coalition with your predecessor, Councilmember Carnegie, in passing the commercial tenant harassment legislation that program is built off of. So it's something that we're looking forward to working with you in this term. ANHD and USB NYC support the City Council in examining the role of the Department of Small Business Services in supporting microenterprise or microbusiness. For the purpose of USB NYC's work, we have defined small business as those businesses with fewer than 20 employees. Using this framework, it is clear that small businesses are in dire need of support from both the Department of Small Business Services and the city as a whole. Our small businesses, as we've heard throughout this morning and now into the afternoon, are a central component to New York City's economic and cultural vitality. Under the combined pressures of landlord harassment, impending displacement, commercial warehousing, and a lack of affordable commercial spaces, small businesses face unprecedented challenges in the current commercial landscape. Historically, there have been no protections for commercial tenants outside of their lease, leaving them vulnerable to landlord harassment. And in cases where there are no leases, it's even worse. With the passage of the city's commercial tenant harassment law, we have begun to turn the tide on this imbalance of power. And we applaud the Department of Small Business Services for the launch of its commercial lease assistance program. And we look forward to working with both the department and the city as a whole to further empower commercial tenants and to also build out and empower that law, the existing commercial tenant harassment law. I'm just moving along through my testimony. Warehouse storefronts are unsightly and reduce foot traffic for existing small businesses, reduce available rental space for new small businesses, and act as a mechanism for speculation, especially in communities of color where landlords hold on to vacant spaces in order to wait for real estate prices to rise and rent the property to newer and wealthier clientele. Commercial warehousing is the small business displacement that enacts cultural displacement. And currently, there are no mechanisms in place to penalize property owners who neglect vacant properties or intentionally leave space vacant. This ultimately stacks the deck against the remaining businesses in neglected corridors. And then this was brought up multiple times throughout the morning, but a major challenge to small businesses struggling to hold on is our out-of-control real estate market. And on the residential side, which is where ANHD has started off, one solution has been to work with nonprofits to develop affordable units. This has been facilitated through different financial incentives and tools available to said nonprofits, and this model is starting to be applied outside of the residential side on a citywide scale, with the city's nonprofit industrial development fund being the most noteworthy example. So we would want to apply that same model to commercial conversations. And just to wrap up, a lot of the conversations around this is built around having access to better data. I think it was brought up in testimony earlier in terms of not knowing what is the citywide vacancy rate for commercial spaces. We don't have that information. And as a closing note, the previous council passed this very lengthy planning for retail diversity report that has a number of recommendations to address a number of the issues that were raised throughout the morning. I think it's worth using that as a blueprint to start a lot of these conversations so that we can actually start enacting some real changes to support our small businesses. Thank you.
Thank you for your time. That was wonderful, and I promise you that we will.
Great. Thank you.
This long hearing is now officially closed. Thank you.